Well, hello, Christ Community Church family, and welcome to church. This is week two, or we are online only, and we're glad that you're here, at least here digitally, virtually. We're glad that we're able to do this together. We are not able to meet together, but it reminds me of something that the Apostle Paul said on a couple of occasions. There were at least two occasions where he wrote to churches that he couldn't be with physically. He said, although I'm absent from you in body, I'm present with you in spirit. And so today, in that spirit, a spirit of unity, a spirit of a common purpose and of longing to be together with one another, let's today worship our King together, virtually, with one another. Let's worship him because he reigns over his church, whether we're together in body or only in spirit. Either way, he reigns, and it's our delight and our joy to worship him. So let's do that today together.
Washed away. Never
Thank you, Dean and the worship team, for leading us in worship. I look forward to when we all get to be here together on a Sunday morning and we get to participate in worship in person. So thank you, Dean and the worship team, for leading us today in worship. Well, would you bow with me in prayer? Father, we do want to thank you this today for this opportunity that we have to meet together digitally, virtually, at least in this way. We all long to be together in person, but we want to thank you that you've given us this opportunity where we can be the church virtually, digitally. Father, we're grateful that we live in a day and age where we can take advantage of these kinds of digital platforms, where we can maintain at least some measure of community, fellowship, some measure of connectedness. Again, we long to be together in person, but we want to thank you nonetheless that we have this opportunity to be together online. Father, we also want to just continue praying for our church family and for our community and beyond. Lord, we want to continue to pray for those who are especially at risk, the vulnerable, those who are at higher risk of the transmission of this virus. We want to continue to pray for them, Lord, and ask that you would protect them, that you would spare them. Father, we want to pray as well for those who have already been affected, whose jobs have already been affected by this virus, or whose jobs will be affected in the coming days or weeks. We pray that you would provide them what they need during this time. Father, we want to pray as well for our people who are on the front lines. We think of doctors and nurses, our first responders, and other medical personnel. We ask, Lord, that you would give them great wisdom and grace to minister and to serve well those who are in need of their care. And so we want to lift up them to you today and ask that you be with them. Father, even as we do pray for protection and comfort during these uncertain times, I want to pray as well for boldness and for courage. I was reminded this week of how your people so often in the Bible, when they were facing trials and tribulations and difficulties, hardships, that they would often, Lord, pray for courage and boldness to be a light, to be a witness for Christ, for the sake of the kingdom and the gospel. And so I pray, Lord, that you would use your church today during this time to be a witness for the sake of the kingdom of Christ. So, Lord, would you give us boldness and courage during these uncertain times? And we'll thank you in advance for what you'll do in and through us for the sake of the gospel. Father, we also want to pray for the offering that we'll receive this week. Though we aren't receiving one today in person, we want to pray, Lord, that your people would continue to give generously as they have. And we give, Lord, whether we give online or whether we send in our gifts and our offerings this week by mail, however we choose to give, Lord, we want to give as a sign of our gratitude to you for what you have first done for us in Christ. So we ask, Lord, that you would receive our gifts and our offerings as our act of worship to you. And now, Father, we want to pray together as the body of Christ, the way that the Lord Jesus taught us to pray when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Well, thank you for praying with me just now. Just a few things to mention by way of announcements today. How can we stay connected with one another during this time where we're not meeting together in person? Well, let me encourage you, if you haven't done so already, to like and follow us, our church, Christ Community Church, on Facebook. We're putting a lot of content on Facebook right now, a lot of information that's going out. So if you haven't already done so, again, let me encourage you to find our Facebook page, like and follow us so you're not missing any content that we're putting out. Subscribe to our YouTube channel as well. We're putting a lot of information and a lot of content on YouTube during this time. You can find a link to our YouTube channel. There are a lot of Christ Community churches, so if you try to find our church on YouTube, you may have difficulty. But you can find a link to our YouTube channel if you visit our website, ccczion.org. We have a link right there on the homepage. Click on that link. It'll take you right to our YouTube channel. Again, subscribe and don't miss any content that we're putting out. Also, check our website often. It's another avenue, another way that we're putting out a lot of information right now. And feel free to call us. We're here in the office, regular business hours. Although the church building is closed for normal activities, we're still here. And we're ready to answer the phones, to answer any questions you might have at this time. So feel free to call us if you have questions or you think you might have missed some important information. Again, give us a call. We're here for you. Also, check out our video blogs. Over the past couple of weeks, Pastor Ken and some of us others have been putting out some information, some devotionals on our website, on our Facebook page, on our YouTube channel as well. Devotionals that we hope will be of encouragement to you during this time of uncertainty. So check those out, and we hope and pray that those will be an encouragement to you. Well, Saturday, April 4th, we have a special opportunity for you. We're going to live stream the play Fish Eyes at 7 o'clock on our Facebook page. So again, 7 o'clock on our Facebook page, we're going to live stream the play Fish Eyes. It's a play, it's a story about two brothers. You may know them, or at least know of them, Peter and Andrew. And the play, it follows their life as fishermen, and it traces their meeting of Jesus and how Jesus turned their life upside down. So you'll want to tune in again on Saturday, April 4th at 7 o'clock on our Facebook page for this event. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, Sunday, April 5th. We will be online only again next Sunday, Palm Sunday, April 5th. Next Sunday is also the sacrificial offering. You may have already received a letter in the mail from Pastor Mike explaining the sacrificial offering and how you can give. If you haven't received that letter yet, you will in the next couple of days. If you think that maybe you haven't received that letter, again, give us a call here at the church. But inside that letter, you'll find an offering envelope. Go ahead and put your offering in there for the sacrificial offering, and feel free to just mail that in, and we'll receive it here at the church. Well, that's all that I'm going to say by way of announcements. Again, just to reiterate, next Sunday, April 5th, Palm Sunday, we're going to be online only, so tune in just like you did today for our worship service. Well, today we're going to take a little bit of a break from our current sermon series, Great Texts in Isaiah, and we're going to take a look at Romans chapter 8 to see what Romans 8 has to say to us during these times. So if you have a copy of God's Word, let me encourage you with me to open up to Romans chapter 8. Romans chapter 8, give you a moment to turn there. We're going to start reading at Romans 8:28 through the end of the chapter. Romans 8:28 says this: "And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. For those God foreknew, He also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of His Son, that He might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those He predestined, He also called. Those He called, He also justified. Those He justified, He also glorified. What then shall we say in response to this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare His own Son, but gave Him up for us all, how will He not also, along with Him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen.
A young missionary named Glenn Chambers was about to begin his missions career in South America. He was in the Miami airport waiting for his flight to Bogota and remembered that he had intended to send his mother a note. Well, he had a stamp and he had an envelope, but he didn't have anything to write on, so he tore a page out of a magazine he found lying there in the waiting area and scribbled his note, put it in the mail, and boarded his flight. But he never got to Bogota. His plane crashed into the side of a 14,000-foot mountain and plunged in fiery ruin into the ravine below. His mother heard of his death, and then a few days later got this letter. She recognized his handwriting on the envelope and opened it with trembling hands and read his last words, which had been scrawled in the margin around a word in bold, all caps, print from an advertisement on that page. The word was, "Why?" Why indeed? Why do bad things happen to God's people? Why does God allow suffering for his individuals and his community and his world? God's people have been asking that question for a long, long time. And for a long, long time, they have been turning to the Word of God for answers and reassurance. And perhaps to no single verse in the Bible more frequently than Romans 8:28. I've preached on this text before, but it seemed appropriate to bring it back again for this time in which we find ourselves. Here again, the words of the text that you heard Pastor Drew read, but just this one powerful, reassuring verse. We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Really? Really? That sentence seems sweeping and certain. Sweeping because the Apostle Paul, who wrote it, says all things. We believe that in all things God works for good. We might be able to believe that God works in some things, even some bad things. We have enough life experience to realize that sometimes through suffering, through evil, or in spite of evil, through the dark times that God brings us through as individuals or as communities, he achieves good. But are we prepared to believe with Paul that in all things God works for good? And the sentence is more certain than we might like to be. Paul doesn't say, "We think," or "We fervently hope," but "We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him." Well, I think if we understand three key words in this text, we will be able to embrace it for ourselves, to really believe it and find in it the reassurance that God wants us to have from these words. Three key words, and you'll see them, or two of the three anyway, if you look at your copy of God's Word. The first word is works. God works. Christians do not believe that all of the circumstances of life just somehow turn out for good, by happenstance, by luck. No, Christians believe that a good, wise, an all-powerful God is at work in all our circumstances. Imagine that you visit a car manufacturing plant in Detroit or Ohio or somewhere, and on one side of the building you see huge doors open and trucks back up to those doors and unload steel and wire and plastic and glass, and then the doors close, the trucks drive away, and you go around to the other side of the building and other huge doors open and out come shiny new automobiles. Well, you don't go, "Wow, what luck! Raw materials in one side, cars come out the other side." Now, you know that inside of that plant, even though you haven't gone in and you haven't seen it with your own eyes, skilled workers are working on that raw material. But we can't always see what God is doing. The doors, if you will, are closed for us. But we have confidence that God works. Look with me for a moment at verse 32 of this great chapter, Romans chapter 8. Verse 32 says, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things?" If God was willing to give us the very best that he had to give, his own son, how can we imagine that he's going to get cheap now and withhold from us anything that he knows is really good for us? If God went to great lengths on the cross on our behalf, can we think that now he's going to stop working on our behalf? No. In fact, the cross illustrates how God can be at work for good even in the darkest circumstances. Think about it. From one point of view, the cross was the worst crime in the history of the world. Not only the crucifixion of an innocent man, but the murder of the God-man. And yet, at the same time, it was the crowning moment of God's plan to save the world. The cross ought to assure us, among many other things that it teaches us, that God is at work for good, even in the darkest circumstances. The second word I think we need to understand if we're really going to appropriate and believe Romans 8:28 is the word together. Now, it's not in our version, but it is in some English versions, and it is in Paul's Greek. It is just difficult to translate this verse and get all of the meaning into good English. The King James Version says, and many of us memorized this when we were Sunday school children, God works, all things work together for good for those who love God, work together. And why is that important? Because so many of the circumstances and experiences of our lives individually are ugly, painful, evil, but together work for good. I doubt that very many of you would be interested in eating some of the ingredients of a chocolate cake individually. Shortening, baker's chocolate, flour, raw eggs. No, individually they're no good, but give them to me with a mixing bowl and an oven, and what do you get? Chaos. But give them to a skilled baker, and you get a delicious dessert. Similarly, many of the experiences that we have in life, taken individually, are not much fun, but taken together, work for good. The classic illustration of this truth in the Bible is the Joseph story. His father Jacob's favoritism was bad. Joseph's conceit was bad. His brother's hatred was bad. Their selling him into slavery was bad. His temptation was bad. His unjust imprisonment was bad. And yet, all the while, God was at work to bring Joseph to a position of authority where he was able to save many lives, including the family of the promised Messiah. And as Joseph himself put it toward the end of that story in Genesis, he said to his brothers, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good." God works. God works all things together. And then the third key word that helps us understand and believe this reassuring passage is that word good. When we use the word good, we often think in terms of something like comfort. If we're in robust health, that's good. If our bodies are not stabbed by pain or invaded by some deadly virus, that's good. If there's enough money in our checking account at the end of the month to spend it on some luxuries after all the bills are paid, that's good. But that's not what the Apostle Paul means by the word good. Or sometimes we think of good in terms of success. If we have achieved a measure of influence or prestige, if we get ahead in a competitive field, that's good. But let's face it, if that or comfort is what Paul meant by good, then he's out of touch with reality. This is just not true to life. Or maybe good means something like the achievement of our noblest ambitions. Well, that's getting warmer, but it's still not quite what Paul means by good. In fact, he tells us in verse 29 what he means by good. All things God works together for the good of those who love him. And then verse 29 says, "For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son." Now, for now, today, we'll set aside discussions of predestination and foreknowledge. Just notice that the good God intends for his children is Christ-likeness. He is working to conform us to the likeness of his Son. What God is doing in our lives is trying to make us like Jesus. And in and of ourselves, we are so unlike Jesus. God has to discipline, correct, chisel, prune. And that hurts. It's unpleasant. You can read all about that in Hebrews chapter 12, God's unpleasant but necessary and good process of making his people more like Jesus. Somebody might be thinking, if that's what this verse means by good, then preacher, you're sounding kind of like my mother when she tried to get me to eat food I didn't like. Eat your spinach. It's good for you. And you might even think, I never asked to be made good. No, thank you, Lord. Well, the truth is, God loves you too much to settle for your inadequate version of good. Okay, you think, I get that. I can see that God's idea of good is what I really ought to long for, and I can even see that sometimes suffering, difficulty, trials might be part of the process that make me good in that sense. But please, Lord, don't make me too good, just a little bit good. Well, C.S. Lewis anticipated that line of argument years ago when he wrote an oft-quoted paragraph. Imagine yourself as a living house. God comes in to rebuild that house. At first, perhaps, you can understand what he is doing. He's getting the drains right and stopping the leaks in the roof and so on. You knew that those jobs needed doing, and so you are not surprised. But presently, he starts knocking the house about in a way that hurts abominably and does not seem to make any sense. What on earth is he up to? The explanation is that he is building quite a different kind of house than the one you thought of. Throwing out a new wing here, putting on an extra floor there, running up towers, making courtyards. You thought you were going to be made into a nice, comfortable little cottage. But he is building a palace. He intends to come and live in it himself. That would be a great place to stop this message, but there's one more important thing to notice about this reassuring passage. It's not for everybody. It wasn't meant to be reassuring for everybody, but for those who love God and are called, chosen, according to God's redemptive purpose. We know that in all things God works things together for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose. I hope you're one of those people. Join me in prayer, won't you? Heavenly Father, thank you for these words, and not just human words, but your sure word to all who have ears to hear, to all who are in a right relationship with you by faith in your Son, your appointed Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We who have received the free gift that He offers can know for sure that you are still at work on our behalf, even when we can't see it behind those closed doors, even when we don't like it. So help us, whatever we face in the days and weeks, months and years to come until you take us to be with yourself, to hang on to this great text, to not quote it glibly, but to believe it with all our heart. And let it make a difference in the way we face whatever we face. In Jesus' name and for Jesus' sake we pray. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace.